join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Joe Galati.
It couldn't have been better,
everybody. Thank you, Mark. And so I did get a lot of text messages, emails, phone calls about bros and brisket. They're like, you're the doctor. You're talking about food. You're talking about nutrition. How come it wasn't bros and cauliflower or something like that? All right, so where was I? I was getting a bit of a hassle about the brisket, but that's okay. Even Father Drew at Mass made some comments. But if you noticed, I've added two Lipitors to go next to your potato salad there, so that'll sort of even things out. All right, so going back, I grew up in New York, and my high school was Holy Trinity High School, and when I was a senior, my principal called me and a few other kids down to talk with us. And one by one, we went into his office and we had a little bit of small talk, what was going on. And then he said, what were your career plans? And I said, well, you know, I want to go to college. And he said, well, have you ever thought about the priesthood? And so I turned white, red, green. I wasn't quite sure. He says, well, you're at the liturgy all the time. You participate in all the church activities at school. And I said, I really plan on going to medical school and being a doctor. And so he said, well, that's great. He says, Joe, just make sure you're a good Catholic doctor. And I, 17 years old, and that stuck with me. And I try every single day, every encounter with patients that I see, to be a good Catholic doctor. And so to be here today to talk to all of you really is truly a treat. And I hope that for all of you, you're here for different reasons, you have different situations. Hopefully there's something here that you can take home tonight. So the main question is, why are we here tonight? What is this all about? Certainly the fellowship of each other, our Christian faith, and talking with one another and eating, of course. But if I could leave you with anything, it is to seek out knowledge about your own health and take that knowledge and take action. There needs to be some kinetic activity with related to your health and wellness, to seek out information, to seek out a better understanding of diseases and prevention and what risks you may have, and then take that in and take action, either for yourself or for your family. And I'll hopefully this will all make sense as we move on. So one question is, how do we achieve wellness if that's what we're really looking for? Well, the first question is, what exactly is wellness? Now, for some people, it might be, can you run a mile in under 10 minutes? Can you do 25 push-ups? Can you walk upstairs at work? Do you get a good night's sleep where you don't get up and pee seven times? It's all very different for everybody. I would say, and the way I want you to look at this is, wellness is the absence of chronic disease. Not having chronic disease. And so you have to look at yourself and say, hey, where do I fit in? Do I have one chronic disease or do I have five? If that's the case, you're not in that wellness, and you're not in that wellness spot. Now, let me tell you a quick question. It's Christmas 1968. And there was a gentleman that my father worked with, Murray Lieber. He was an Orthodox Jewish gentleman. My father was in pharmaceutical sales. And he was a very religious Jew. And at Christmas time, he would make, in his little wood shop in his garage, Christmas ornaments for his Catholic and Christian friends. And we knew a week or two before Christmas, Murray Lieber was going to drop off a Christmas ornament for us. And I was 6, 7, 8 years old. And so this one year, 1968, A manila envelope is on the kitchen table, and we knew it was addressed to the Galati children. It was Mr. Lieber's Christmas present. So I run, rip it open, and it was a wooden cedar shake, you know, like a piece of siding. Had a little Christmas bling on it, some junky little things sort of glued on it, little green and red little sparkles, and a little hook, and with a wood-burning pen, all it said was, "Misery is optional." So you're 9 years old, and I look at my mother, I said, "This is a total jip. This is the worst. We're going to put this on our tree." And absolute truth, my mother put her arm around me and she said, "Joseph, you do not understand the significance of this message. Misery is optional." Now, fast forward to today. It is a joke amongst siblings, cousins, in-laws. If anything is going bad, you're having a bad day, something's wrong, and you're sharing it with somebody else, they will be on, they're like, "Come on, misery is optional." And so I look at that from health. So a lot of the misery that we allow ourselves to suffer from bad health, it's optional. It is absolutely optional, because about 85% of all the chronic disease that we see is lifestyle related. It can be changed. So misery, just remember, misery is optional. So here are the usual suspects of the chronic diseases that we see that are taking everybody down. At the top of the list, it's obesity. There are 75, 80% of the population is overweight or obese. That is the driving force for hypertension, high blood pressure, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, fatty liver, that the disease that I deal with predominantly. There's 80 to 100 million Americans with fatty liver, leading cause of cirrhosis and the need for a liver transplant. Unbelievable. Kidney disease, the need for dialysis, arthritis, all sorts of disabilities from not being able to walk, and of course our mental health and depression and anxiety, and people are just not feeling really well. So what I say, now again, I want to inspire all of you. I want you to think. But our health has been dumbed down. We are accepting of rotten health. Just come to accept it. You talk to anybody, "How do you feel?" "Yeah, you know, I got heartburn, I have reflux, I have sleep apnea, my knees hurt." But that's life. No, it's not life. Okay? Patients will come into me, and I have the luxury of looking at 5 inches of medical records that span 10 years. And I'm looking through, and I'm like, "How long has your blood sugar been up?" "Well, I don't know, 5-6 years. "Well, what did the doc say?" "Well, you just, it's just a touch of diabetes." That's like being a touch dead. "Oh, you, Mary, you're a touch pregnant." Not Mother Mary, but some other Mary. It doesn't work that way. And so I see patients every day, and everything I'm saying here is based on my life, my practice, day in, day out. People have a touch of cholesterol, just a touch of cholesterol. "Oh, you're going to treat it?" "No, it's just a touch." Wrong. You have to aggressively treat all these things. And then when somebody has a heart attack, they're like, "How did that happen?" "Well, you had a touch of diabetes for 10 years. So it's we just come to accept this. Patients come in. They're not feeling well. They're fatigued. They're tired. It's like, "Doc, I'm turning 30 next month." I'm like, "30? Lord, you should be full of energy and vigor." But the same is for 30 and 40. And they have these, everybody's got these preconceived ideas that at 50 you should be feeling like this, and at 60 by that, and by 70 forget about it. You're decrepit. We just can't accept it. And what I say is, there's this low health IQ. Now, meaning by that, there isn't that connection that, gee, that pain on the lower part of my abdomen, why is that happening? I don't know. Why is it that when I walk upstairs, I get short of breath? I don't know. Low IQ. Now, it sounds, I'm not here to be condescending or nasty or anything like that, but it is the truth. You have to know how this body works, and you have to listen to your body. And so patients come in, they have an assortment of complaints, and they're not asking questions. Why do I have reflux? Why do I burp? Why does it hurt when I swallow? Why do I have diarrhea? Why do I'm constipated? Why do I see blood in my stool? I don't know. Now, people will know the inside out of their muscle car. Every nut, every bolt, every filter, every O-ring, I don't know. We got some motorheads in the audience here, I know. So, but anyway, you talk about their car, they could tell you everything about it. How about your body? Clueless. Okay? So think. Got to raise your health IQ. Treat your body like a 65 muscle car. And so we are on a mission. We started that way. And so every day I am at work. And again, Mark mentioned the radio, the side hustle. That is strictly an extension of my day-to-day work, trying to communicate. So every Sunday, I start off the show trying to raise your health IQ one listener at a time. I don't know, there's 150 people there. If one person gets something, it's a good night for me. And hopefully a good night for you, too. But the mission here is to really make you think about your health. And it doesn't matter whatever age. The research has been done that if you're out of shape and you're chronically ill and you start lifting weights at 75 years old, your body will change and be healthier. So don't think there's some line in the sand where it's like, I'm 75. What the heck do I want to start going to the gym for? It's really, really never too late. And so it's a reality check. Similar to our faith, you got to look in the mirror and say, what am I doing here? What's my MO here? And it's tough. It really is tough to admit that things may not be right, that you're not feeling well. But it really does pay off. So getting down to one of the core things that I've experienced is the three Fs: family, faith, and food. So that is a sticky note I jotted down at a funeral home when I was preparing my mom's funeral, which is a fun thing to go pick out caskets, by the way. I'm sure you've all had to do it. So I get a call from our deacon, and he said, Joe, the priest at the church said it's okay for you to speak at mom's funeral tomorrow. Just, you know, you'll have 10 minutes. Put your thoughts together. So I was sitting there waiting for the funeral director salesman guy to come back, and I'm sitting there with a sticky pad, and I said, okay, what do I say about mom? How do I start this all off? So I said, well, family to her was paramount. It was the key. Family, 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 family. Nothing got in the way of the family. Her faith was exemplary. We grew up in a Catholic family on Long Island. Not Long Island, but Long Island. And similar to what we've done with our children here, everything we did was at the church. And then, of course, food. Being Italian, my parents were first-generation Italians. We were somewhere between, sort of like Everybody Loved Raymond, you know, remember that show? But strong Italian family, food and family were one in the same. And so that was my mother. She loved cooking, not for the sake of cooking, but for the sake of feeding us good food that was fresh, she took care. She would almost caress a pepper to say, look at this gift from God, how beautiful it is and how tasty it is. And I'm going to turn it into something that's going to satisfy not only the family, but friends and neighbors that would come over. And so I started to think, as I was talking about this and getting my notes ready for Mom, that maybe the three F's are the key to wellness. If you could merge all of that together, honestly, and I'll show you how. So this is my parents, Joe and Aggie, at the 1965 World's Fair. I think it was probably one of the earliest photographs I ever took. My father was in pharmaceutical sales his entire life, and my mother was a professional secretary. She worked at Pfizer in New York City. So we had a lot of medical talk at the kitchen table. But my parents, and to the day they died, they would always talk about this, that when they got married, their master plan was to have a family, have a faithful family, and do everything for the kids, to keep everybody together. They would do anything for us. And here's my mom with the three of us, myself and my two sisters. We did everything together with family and cousins and neighbors, and it was just a great way to grow up. I feel very, very blessed the way I was brought up. Now, fast forward a year or so after Mom died, we're in Montserrat, Spain, at an abbey, and there was a small art gallery. And it was December, it was right before Christmas, and it was absolutely frigid outside. And to hide from the bad weather, I leave my family and I run into the art gallery. Just, I had to cool off. I didn't have a hat and I lost my gloves, you know, like a 5-year-old boy. And so I walk into this rather small art gallery, and it was almost as if it was a miracle. This room that I walked into, just a sea of artwork, but this painting just absolutely caught my eye, and it was like there was nothing else in the room, and I just walked right up to this. The name of this painting by a famous Spanish artist from 1943, the name of it was Familia. And I looked at it, and I said, I see my life there. It is a mom with a boy and two girls, very, very lovingly cooking a meal. Everybody seemed happy. It seemed like everybody was sort of involved in the preparation somehow. And that's the way I grew up. So when I was, let's say, 5, I was assigned to peel the garlic. The kid above me would stir the sauce, and the oldest was given a knife to chop up the peppers or whatever it was. And so we were in training growing up on cooking and learning from Mom. And that really stimulated me after losing Mom and all that she taught me, going to Spain and seeing this picture. I tried to get the emotions of my family and what I grew up with and what I believed in, along with, you know, 30 years of patient care, and try to put it to print, and I wrote the book, Eating Yourself Sick. And this is where it started, on Long Island. Very simple, modest little 1,200 square foot house. We didn't need much room. No matter where you were in the house, you could be seen and heard. There was no hiding space, except for the basement, of course. And when you look at family, for me and for so many, it was everything. It was togetherness. We talked to each other. Now you say, is this Sunday? Am I substituting for Father Drew? I'm thinking in the context of health. People not talking to each other. How are you feeling? Your stomach hurts. Your leg hurts. You can't see out of your right eye. Tell me a little bit more. What's going on? Maybe you should see somebody. No, I don't want to see anybody. No. I think this is serious. Let's go see somebody. So we're not communicating. We're in our own little silos. We knew what was going on with each other. We sat and had meals together. There was no excuse. Now, we are all becoming victim of this society that is out of control. We're not eating together, we're not cooking together, we're not talking with each other. And not only is our society going down and our relationships falling apart, our health is falling apart. And we've lost the value of the kitchen table. Sitting together, let's break bread. How was your day? Talk to your kids. Talk to your spouse. And so the power of the meal, you could say, okay, Joe Galati, you got a lot of emotion here. You're really cranked up on this. Let's go to the research, or as we've learned over the last few years, let's go to the science. So you look at children. You look at children that have eaten meals with their family. They have better eating habits. Okay, that's a good thing. They have better vocabularies. They have better grades. Closer family relationships. Fewer risky behaviors. All right? There's a ton of those you could get in trouble with. Lower risk of obesity, that's good, and better overall health. And I say, who doesn't want this for their kids or their grandkids? I think we all would want it, but it's getting back to the kitchen table. Sounds old-fashioned, but it works. The alternative is not all that good. So how do we tie in this whole faith and health thing? Okay? So where's that road of faith and the road to health? But there are quotes throughout the Bible, maybe Father Drew could drop one for us, questioning about Jesus wants you to love yourself, right? And you really, it's sort of said, how could you love somebody else without loving yourself? How about loving your family, right? That is the key. You have to love yourself to love others. But are you neglecting yourself? And I see that so often, where we are neglecting ourselves at the cost of doing other things. And when I say neglecting yourself from a health standpoint, you may be neglecting yourself from a faith standpoint as well. And I call this the do-gooder syndrome. I made that up. So the do-gooder syndrome is this. Or a person is so good to everybody else that they forget about themselves. Maybe they even neglect their own family. But they're the do-gooder volunteering for everything. Now, we want you to volunteer. I think later on we're going to hear about various things that you could participate here at the church, right? We want you. We need people to run this engine. But are you such a do-gooder that you don't even take care of yourself? And if you're not well, how do you take care of yourself? How do you take care of your family? So watch out for do-gooder syndrome or do-gooderitis. Can I say that, Mark? Do-gooderitis? Okay. And how do you lead if you're sick? Now, no women here, though there were a bunch of women that wanted to come attend here. But as men, as Catholic men, leaders of our community, leaders of our family, for our children, our spouse, everybody, the whole community, your work community, the people that you work for, the people that work for you. How do you lead? How are you that stone, the rock, that pillar, that bridge, that trust that stays up if you're sick? Honestly. Now, I don't mean to be doom and gloom here, but people count on us. People count on husbands and dads and bosses to be healthy, to be there for them, to lead. And I would say, and I say this from taking care of thousands upon thousands and thousands of patients that come in, and when they are sick and they hit rock bottom, everything in their family falls apart. They lose their company. They lose their job. They lose their insurance. Wives leave. Kids leave them. It's disastrous. Things just absolutely unravel. And so, am I pleading with you? I'm trying to inspire you. You have to take care of yourselves. Stay healthy so that you could be there for everybody else as that dad, that man for each other. So talking about food. So I love food. I love to cook. I love to eat. I love to serve. I love to have people over. This was our dining room table at my mom's house. And somebody actually looked and they said, do I see Italian pastries there? Yes, this was a dessert shot of the table. But this was where all the action came over when people would visit. And about 10 years ago, a group of 10 non-medical colleagues of mine, we flew to New York for a retreat. And the first stop was my parents' house, where my mother and father just cooked up a classic Italian feast for them. And that's my mother standing in the back. And if you look closely, she is like overlooking how one of the guys is cutting the food and serving it and looking for that expression. And it wasn't like, oh, Mrs. Galati, you're like the greatest cook on earth. She wanted to hear that, boy, this tasted good. I've never had anything like this. Peppers, eggplant, I never had that before. That could taste pretty good. And she would always say that it was absolutely cooked with love. And to this day, 10 years later, these guys are still talking about it. They're still talking about it. But this was her absolute, her love. My mother didn't smoke. She didn't drink. Her drug, and she was an addict, was food and feeding us. That was her addiction. And she absolutely, absolutely loved it. And it wore off on so many people. Now, by cooking, by eating together, it brings people together. We talk. We check each other out. Maybe somebody's got a problem and we're sitting there over a meal, relaxed. And people open up. We need that. And I like to say, cooking is cool. My sense is that most women like a guy that could cook a good meal. Right? Not, you know, sort of out of the can to warm it up. But if you could cook, you guys here, learn how to cook, you'll be a magnet. Okay? And so here I am. I really don't play golf. I don't have a motorcycle. I don't hunt. I don't fish. I do the radio thing, Mark, once again. But I invested in building an outdoor kitchen in our backyard. And it's a wood-burning pizza oven. And we built it when the kids were late grade school here at St. Laurence, early high school. That pizza oven became a magnet for all of their friends to come over and eat. And all of a sudden, Mr. Galati was the cool dad making pizzas. And the kids, my kids were shocked at it. I said, look, we're bringing your friends together. We're getting to know them better. And these kids would talk to me and Geraldine and each other. I'm like, you know, you talking to your parents? You know, we should. We're sitting at our table. So the value of cooking and eating, especially at home, is really key. So what I see is that there's a lack of cooking skills. A lot of people don't know how to cook. Absolute truth. My daughter was at Texas A&M. Maybe in her second year, she calls me up one night and she said, Dad, I actually have a roommate that does not know how to boil water. And I'm like, really? And she's like, yeah, she just did not know how to boil water. And she hung up. So there is a whole generation, and these are our kids, these are our grandkids, raised in families that didn't cook and didn't sit at the dinner table. There was no dominant cooking figure in the home. Fragmented families, whole other story, but it trickles down to your health. No real interest in cooking, and really limited cooking skills. I had a woman, this goes back about 10 years, very serious problems, diabetes, she was obese, she had liver disease, and I was talking with her, and she said, you know, I did lose about 90 pounds a couple of years ago. I said, well, what happened? She put all the weight back on. She said, I got sick of chicken. I said, you got sick of chicken? She said, yeah, for a year, I ate boiled chicken. I said, now, come on. Boiled chicken, pot of water, throw the chicken in, wait 5 minutes, eat it? She says, yeah. I said, do you have a barbecue? Yeah. I said, why don't you, like, heat up the Weber, right? Little olive oil, pepper. She says, I didn't know how to grill chicken. I said, how? Cut it up, put it in a pan, and stir fry it. No. How about the oven? You have an oven? Yeah, I have an oven. I don't know how to bake it. Now, this was a 40-something-year-old woman employed by one of the oil companies in town here, bright lady, did not know how to cook. So from that point, I started asking people, hey, do you know how to cook? Nah, I don't cook. I just, you know, the old joke, what do you make for dinner? Reservations. So we're in trouble that people don't know how to cook. You know, you tell us, you know, the doctor, you got to eat better. I don't know how to eat better. So this, I'm very concerned about this entire generation that's going to be lost. And then as far as cooking at home, this gets even more entertaining. People are too busy. It's too hard. It's too hard to cook, Dr. Galati. What do you mean it's too hard? Right? You know, there's like only 18 billion videos on YouTube that you could cook anything. We're surrounded by all sorts of food options. Why should I go cook and shop if I could just have DoorDash? Or as I'm coming home from the office, I'm passing about 6,000 places I could go eat. The other big excuse is I don't want to clean up. There are people that have a phobia of carrot peels. I don't know what it is. They don't want carrot peels in their sink. Well, I'm not going to. I got to clean that stuff up. This is the absolute truth. I mean, I am not making any of this up. I want to point out Anthony Santos, raise your hand, one of my nurse practitioners. He has to listen to this every day as well. And we just like meet in the hallway. We're like, another one doesn't want to cook. And I'm stressed out. So you're stressed out, don't want to cook. It's a big problem. But the cleaning up and too much of a mess is just, again, misery is optional. If you look back 1975, the golden years, there were only about 9,000 products in your typical grocery store. Now, in 2008, almost 50,000 different products. I mean, it's unbelievable. Now, they have not come up with a better pepper or a zucchini or a carrot. It's all the frozen manufactured fake food that we're buying, okay? So now, as a consumer, we're being just hammered with not knowing what to buy. Gluten-free, fat-free, sugar-free, low-cal, high-cal, no sugar. I don't know. Okay, that looks good. There's a heart on it. I'll buy it. And so we have to bring back the family dinner. That is the core of our faith ills, our social ills, our relationship ills, and our health ills. Okay? Now, one little thing I like to talk about is God food versus man food. So God food came from the ground or had a mother. Okay? Everything else is man food. Don't eat man food. We want to eat God food. Okay? I think you know what that is. And I would say, you know, if the food you eat rots on the counter overnight, that's a good food to eat, okay? But if you take something and it has a shelf life for 47 years, don't go there, okay? All right, we're going to change gears real fast. Alcohol. Now, alcohol is sort of out of the realm of the family faith and food, but this is such a big problem that we see that it is worthwhile spending a couple of minutes here. So when you talk about alcohol, there is a tremendous misunderstanding about alcohol. So people will commonly come in and say, just on a general question, you know, we're not like drilling you if you're an alcoholic or not. Just tell them how much alcohol you drink, right? Just like how much smoke do you have and do you exercise? And like, oh, no, I do not drink. Okay, that's good. But then there's a dramatic pause and they'll say, but I have a six pack of beer every night. I'm like, that's alcohol, right? Oh, no, that's not alcohol. I gave up the hard stuff. The other is vodka. Okay, vodka is good for you because the spirit that's distilled and real dark, that's got toxins in it. So the more clear it is, the healthier it is for you. I'm like, okay, got to go back to kindergarten here. So whether it's beer, wine, or spirit, clear, dark, I don't care what color it is, one serving, so one bottle of beer, an ounce and a half of spirit, or about 5 ounces of wine, sort of a regular glass. Not these big glasses, you see these things that hold an entire bottle of wine? That's trouble. They all have the exact same amount of alcohol, about 10 grams of alcohol. So if you're worried about your buddy that's having six margaritas, oh, he's drinking too much, but you're knocking back six beers, same thing, okay? So a beer, a shot, or a glass of wine, exact same amount of liquor. Now, this is the part where everybody groans. For women, one alcoholic beverage per day is the max. For men, two per day. Now, people will raise their hand. Dr. Galati, how about if I have like 14 beers on Friday night? Am I good? No, that's called binge drinking. And you don't do that. It's one for women, two for men. Now, the complications of alcohol. Now, I am not part of any anti-alcohol lobby in any way. But I see the ill effects 24 hours a day. And like everything else, you can have barbecue as long as you don't eat it for breakfast, lunch, and dinner 365 days a year. You can have an occasional alcoholic beverage as long as you don't have it breakfast, lunch, and dinner 365 days a year. So the complications of chronic ongoing alcohol use, and this is sort of a nasty litany of things. It's liver cancer, cirrhosis, pancreatitis or pancreatic cancer, esophageal cancer, stroke, cardiac disease. Alcohol is directly toxic to the heart muscle. You get immune suppression. You're at risk for certain infections. Damages your nerves. Increased risk of dementia, depression, high blood pressure. Seizures. Nerve damage in your hands and your feet. Anemia. Damages your bone marrow. And oral cancer. So these are the things that you have to watch out for. You're thinking, am I taking too much alcohol? Am I at risk for any of these nasty, nasty things? And so it comes into sort of defining how bad of a problem this is. So over the last few years, the terminology has changed a little bit. We call all of this alcohol use disorder, okay? And the main thing for everybody to sort of just take stock of yourself or somebody in your family or a coworker, whatever it may be, the main trigger here with alcohol use disorder is the impaired ability to stop. So if you have a known medical problem, somebody tells you, you have the atrial fibrillation that you developed from your alcohol, that's probably alcohol related. Or you have a fatty liver or some liver damage, or you have your bone marrow is not working right related to the alcohol use. And you say, no, I'm going to still drink. So in the face of a problem and you continue to drink, that is alcohol use disorder. Or people that have had legal problems, financial problems, occupational issues, relationship problems, there's a problem and you don't stop. That's where you cross the line from just being, you know, tailgating on Saturday afternoon to having a real problem. Now, if you look at these numbers, hopefully you could see them, the numbers are staggering when you look at the number of people that are having trouble with some sort of alcohol problem. Alcohol in youth, okay? Talking at 18 to 25, binge drinking, okay? Roughly about 30% of that population is subjecting themselves to binge drinking. Alcohol use disorder in the U.S., 12 and older, 30 million people. So this is no minor problem. And of course, the thing that always breaks my heart is the underage and drinking and automobile deaths, which is right around 1,500 deaths, needless deaths. And so we talked about the men and women, one drink for women, two for men. Binge drinking would be four for female or five for men within 2 hours, or if you drink it all at the same time. Like you just knock back like four shots at one time or five shots. And then heavy alcohol use would be for women more than three a day or seven in a week, or for men four in a day or 14 in a week. And so I think that this is a busy slide. The main thing is that the earlier you start drinking, the greater the chance you're gonna have trouble with this. Now there is a genetic component. We're not quite there to figure out who's got the genetic predisposition, but the main thing is you want to postpone your alcohol exposure as long as you can. If you want to use 21 as sort of the best spot, that's good. Not drinking till 25 or 30 is even better. But early drinking is a problem. Now, one thing that I get calls a lot is parents that are having a party. They have 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds, underage kids. And they know that they're going to go to a party or a homecoming or whatever the case may be, and they're going to drink. So they will say, you know what, I'm going to set up the bar at my house where I could watch all the kids and support drinking. That is a huge mistake. Okay, that is a huge mistake. The answer is no drinking. Not to say drink under a more controlled environment. It's bad any which way you look at it. So be, you know, if you ever come across that, to say, oh yeah, we're going to that guy's house, but his parents are home and they're going to watch us drink. Once the young brain gets a figurative taste of alcohol, it sets it off like a wildfire. Okay, so even those that are predisposed to alcohol use disorder, if you could get them through a length of time that they're not exposed to alcohol, it protects them. Underage drinking, and we're in the era of the internet and social media and marketing. It now is the drug of choice. And I say this because we have kids, we have grandkids, or we work with young people, and we have to really think about their health. So early alcohol equals the potential for alcohol use disorder. And there's a shift in focus here. So non-drinkers, because of all of the marketing on social media, and these companies have some pretty cool websites. If you're a non-drinker, you're much more receptive to engaging in consuming alcohol. And if you're already a drinker, you're at risk for greater engagement. So again, be careful. So a couple of final words here. I would say all of us get to a point in our life where we're thinking about retirement, or maybe a little earlier, thinking about kids' college or your grandkids' college, and we have a financial planner, we've got our own money guy, and we're online, and we're looking at Bloomberg and everything. We're dialed into Yahoo Stocks. And we start planning for our retirement. Now, what would you do if a colleague of yours, a friend of yours, a neighbor of yours, hits 65, retires, you have a party for him, and then he calls you the next day and says, I didn't save a dime. I am flat out broke. I don't have a nickel to buy a bag of worms to go fishing. You look at him and you say, dude, what have you been doing? You had like an okay job, 401k, nothing. So we have this sense in us to save, plan for retirement, right? All these ads, plan for tomorrow. But there's no thought about our health and fitness planning for retirement. Nobody's sitting here at 50 to say, what kind of shape am I going to be in at 65? What kind of physical condition am I going to be in looking 30 to 40, 40 to 50? None of that, or minimal, or I would say not enough. You have to get in your mindset of thinking about the future. You have to plan, all right? So, a couple of things. One, that's my email. If you'd like to email me, by all means, shoot me an email. That's one of the websites. There's lots of information on there. This is being videoed. Thank you, JD, good friend of mine, good man. We're going to get this up and posted somewhere on the St. Laurence site so that others can see it, or you could listen to whatever we said here tonight again. But I would say that the message here is wellness. When you lose it, you don't realize what you had. If you're struggling with wellness, it's not impossible to gain it back. Now, of course, there are diseases, conditions that are just, you know, beyond getting better, all right? Despite the technology, the surgery, the research, there are some people that are just unable to get better. They just have some sort of end-stage disease. I deal with liver disease. Our lifeboat is transplant. But that's not for everybody. Okay, so yes, transplant is marvelous. I've been doing it over 35 years. But I look at it to say, our patients that we're seeing for transplant now are almost a failure of all of these years of having just a touch of this and a touch of that, and don't worry about it. We're going to watch it. Come back next year. That goes on for years until they hit bottom, and now they're in my office, and we try to fix them, okay? So think of the future. Think about the important role all of you men play in your family, in your community, the people that count on you. You have to be strong. You have to be healthy. Thank you again. This really is, I'm so happy I was able to talk to everybody tonight. Depending on the program here, I could answer questions. I could answer questions outside afterwards. There's some books outside if you want to pick some up. But thank you, thank you, thank you.